All right. This song.
Amen.
Well, we're going to sing them again. Okay?
Yeah, sounds good.
Uncloudy day. They tell me I'm a cloudy coming, where there'll be no more rain, no more cloudy skies. Amen. No more darkness. I feel like traveling on. You feel like traveling on?
Oh yeah.
Amen.
Yeah. Hand me a purple book, please. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, we ought to wound up this morning.
I actually think the grumpies are in this room, and I think you need to pray and get rid of all the grumpy spirits.
Let's pray that the grumpies will leave. Amen. Father, I just come before you today asking, Father, for a spirit of joy and happiness. And we thank you, Father, that we have so much to be thankful for. Lord, that we could now focus on you and sing to you. And we just ask, Lord, that spirits would be lifted up today. And I thank you that the enemy would be stopped in Jesus' name. And we thank you again for the spirit of joy to be here today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
If you're feeling weak, the scripture says the joy of the Lord is your strength. The joy of the Lord. So if you're feeling weak, there's only one fix for that. And that's to have the joy. Amen.
Amen.
I saw that and I wiped it off. I've already wiped it.
Okay. Because it's really bad. Maybe if you step over just a little.
I think it's just the haze of this. Does that look different?
Nope.
Okay.
No, it's really blurry.
All right.
I don't know why it's doing that.
How bizarre. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. I know this is odd for you to be singing out of the books, but for generations, people sang out of books and didn't use a projector, did they?
Nope.
Sometimes they actually sang from memory. Can you imagine that? Back in the old ancient days when people sang from their hearts. Everybody got love lifted me? All right. Thank you. Kneel at the cross. It's the last song in my book. I got one out of tune. I put these strings on this morning, and I haven't got it in good tune, so you'll have to apologize. I have to apologize for that. Singing on that part. Jesus will meet you there. We all know that part, don't we? But do we know the rest of it?
No, I don't think we do.
I don't think we do. I think we need to look at the words again. I know most of you can read, right? And let's sing this song. Now, some of you like to sing the alternate part or the step-in part, especially you young men. And I know down there and kneel at the cross, you can sing the bottom line, kneel at the cross, leave every care, leave every care. Some of you like to talk, now's your chance, right? We can do this, amen?
Amen.
Second verse. Make a little comment about singing. When you're singing, you might think that nobody will notice when you're not singing. And everybody else in here that thinks that too, when everybody does that, nobody's singing. Did you notice how at the end everybody got louder? That's because everybody got louder. You know what? It takes everybody in here singing for us to worship. What if everybody in here is worshiping except for me and I'm Right. I see a lot of that going on. You, hey. Right. Well, let's focus on God today. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I got an amen from the kitchen.
Amen.
Amen. Atta boy. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Do we have a prayer request today? Yes, Isaac.
I wanted to bless this day because my sister Charlotte is having a birthday today.
Amen. He wants to bless this day because it's Charlotte's birthday.
Amen. That was a blessed day it is.
Courtney asked for prayers for her grandson Peyton. He's got a bad cold.
Okay. Peyton.
Peyton.
Peyton, okay. We'll certainly pray for Peyton. Amen.
He's got poison ivy on his belly.
Poison ivy.
Arm.
Okay, Leo, we'll pray for you.
And my back.
And your back, okay. I actually have a little on me this morning. I don't know where I got it.
We need to pray for the beginning of the school year. Lots of families, the kids are going to public school. They're all heading to public school and private school and home school. And
amen.
We need to just pray God's protection and okay. God's blessing.
A new school year. Pray for the teachers, too. Okay, Lisa, we'll lift you up this morning. Yes, Paul.
My Natalie Morris, my dad's sister, she had her lung collapse, and they went in and fixed it. Hmm. And then she went to the ER the other day. For some, I can't remember what, but she is in. She has a lot going on right now, so she needs prayer.
Okay.
You know that?
Yes. Natalie, pray for her lung and some health issues.
It's Stephanie, not Natalie.
Okay. I thought he said Natalie.
He did by accident.
Okay. All right. Pray for Stephanie.
Calvin has caught COVID.
COVID.
He came back from Wisconsin and has COVID. So
okay.
He has yet to get over the original COVID call.
Wow.
So he's praying for him.
Okay. We'll lift up Alvin this morning. There was somebody else that had COVID recently. Who was that? Steve?
He's better.
He's better? Okay.
And if we could pray for Miss Stephanie again, she's okay. Supposed to have another round of chemo this week, I think.
Okay.
Tomorrow, probably. We have a family need of something. We've got sort of a tricky situation of something we need to deal with.
Okay.
But we need wisdom and how to deal with that.
Okay. Wisdom. Pray for family wisdom. Amen. Isaac. Yes, we got a festival coming up, Arts and Crafts Festival, that our family's involved in. We need to be able to be prepared for that. Polly?
I would like to pray for Aunt Amanda and pray for Aunt Olivia.
Okay.
Making up for past weeks.
Yeah. I believe it. Okay. Let's come before the Lord in prayer. Father, we lift up these needs today and ask that you take care of them. Lord, everything from wisdom to healing to salvation, we ask that all of it is covered. Lord, that those that are in the hospital and suffering with breathing issues from COVID and other things that they have, Lord, I just pray that you would touch them. Lord, this child with poison ivy, Lord, this child knows to call on you when they need help. And Father, at this early age, they will always trust in you. Be faithful, Father, to them as they are faithful to you. And I just pray, Father, that you would answer that prayer of that child. And Lord, be with those that need wisdom in family matters, that you would be with those. Give provision, Lord, in these and mercies in chemotherapy. Father, we ask, Lord, that you be with Miss Stephanie in that. And Lord, we ask that you be with this family, Lord, as we prepare for this arts and crafts show, that we would be glorifying your name in it. We thank you, Father, for the word today, and I ask that you would be glorified in your word, and let your son be elevated in our eyes and our hearts today, that we might be more established on him today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. I'm in 1 Peter chapter 2 today. We're going to start a new chapter in 1 Peter. 1 Peter is not jumped right in like James as far as being from the beginning. The first chapter has been not full of the nuggets that James has, but yet it's still a great book to study. And then we're following right on the heels of the book of James study. So if you'll find 1 Peter chapter 2 in your Bibles, and we will begin there. We have looked through quite a bit in chapter 1. We've looked through the value of the blood of Jesus in our lives and his great sacrifice. Peter, as you know, the fisherman that Jesus called, and he was probably one that was foremost in being vocal about the gospel until Paul came. He was the apostle that went out and spoke boldly after the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I just see Peter in a lot of respects as a great man, or somebody that you would want to talk to if he was your neighbor, or, you know, he would be a down-to-earth person. And here he writes in such depth because he has depth. We get depth when we hang around Jesus, don't we? You know, when you read his word, when you study him, when you pray, when you fellowship, and when you fellowship around other Christians, you get depth. We need that in the church. We need to be able to have depth in the church so that the world can see the greatness of the gospel and the greatness of God's love. So I want you to make sure that you try for depth in Christ. If you're satisfied with a average relationship with God and you just are happy with the way things are, that's not good enough.
Amen.
Thank you. I was waiting to see if anybody was listening. If the place that you are today is the same place you was 2 weeks ago or last year, or if it's even less than you was last year, you're going the wrong way. Amen. You need to always have growth. We used to have a plastic plant. We got one right over there. Plastic fern. Right? Angie doesn't have many plastic plants.
Silk.
Oh, it's silk. Okay, it's a silk plant. She doesn't have many fake plants, but that one's there for an example, because that plant looks just exactly like it did 2 years ago. No new leaves, no old leaves, right? It's the same plant because it's dead. Do you get it? It's dead and there's no growth in it. There's no change in it. So if you're the same person or not even as good a person as you was some years back, then you're going the wrong way. You're a dead person. You need to grow. You need to make sure that there's something new happening about you and your relationship with God. And Peter starts off chapter 2. And of course, he wrote this as a continuous letter. So the first word we see is wherefore. And he builds on that last bit of scripture that we studied. Amen. Verse 22, seeing you have purified your souls in obeying the truth from last week. And then chapter 2, verse 1, wherefore, laying aside all malice and guile, all guile and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speakings, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby, if so be you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Now here is something that Peter says in a sense that it's an action. Laying aside all malice and guile, hypocrisies and envies and evil speakings. He says to do this. Now, there's a real false teaching in churches today that when you're born again and God renews your spirit, that there's nothing you do. It happens through time and you just grow. But there's so many scriptures in the New Testament that talk about putting off this, laying aside this. Yesterday, I butchered 4 ducks. When I came in, Angie went like that. I needed to come in screaming, unclean, unclean, because I was filthy, you know, and I had to come in and my clothes were stinking, nasty, didn't want to look at them, went straight in, got the shower, and my clothes went in the washing machine. And I mean, I was dirty, and this was probably 11 o'clock. I was filthy. I had to put off laying aside those things. When you're born again, when you're a Christian, there are things in your life you need to stop doing.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Now, preacher, are you telling me that I'm supposed to actually do something and try to grow? Yes, I am. You know, your children, when your moms and dads are trying to get you to grow up, and they try to, and what do they do when you don't listen to them? They discipline you, right? What do you think God does when we don't listen to him, when we don't do our part, when we don't try to lay aside something, when we just wallow in the mud? You know what? I hate being dirty. I hate stinking. I hate being in the middle of the day completely wet from sweat and things that from butchering ducks. I hate that on me. It was nasty. I was sick at my stomach. I didn't want to eat till 3 or 4 after that afternoon. I mean, I was so filthy. But as Christians, why do we allow sin in our lives when we need to put that off? You know, if you were raised to never take a bath, you wouldn't know any better. But from the time you got the mentality to take a bath and you understood that you could take a bath anytime you wanted to and get clean, why would you not do that? And consequently, as Christians, we need to learn that the sin, the things that God calls sin, is filth, right? It's filth. Verse 16 from the first chapter that we read, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. We expect to come in before God, and we always come to him when we get in trouble, don't we? Or when we want something. We get mad at God, or we get I'm just not happy. My life's not happy. God, you must have done this for me. You know what? Maybe he's waiting on you to change. Right? Here Peter says, laying aside, and it means literally to put away, to lay down, to put off. That's what the Greek word means. To put away, to lay down, to put off. Laying aside all malice. Malice, ill will, desire to injure. So we're supposed to put that off. Well, that's a flesh thing. And I have to tell you, your entire life, you will have to be putting that off. You know, somebody will be pushing your buttons 20 years from now to try to make you mad. The devil knows what makes you mad. He knows what buttons to push in your life to really irritate you. And if you have ill will, that's malice. If you have ill will, desire to injure somebody because they hurt you, then that's wrong. You need to put that off. I remember in high school when there would be some bully picking on me, and I would try to grit my teeth. Right? You don't like people slapping you on the back of the head? Ha, ha, ha! You know, that's something kids do to each other, right? Right? Isn't that right, Nick? Okay. Nick's getting into it over there. He's slapping himself in the head. He's trying to see what it thought. He's like, I don't believe I've ever been slapped in the head. So he had to do it himself. You know, I remember in high school, somebody had picked on me, and they literally, I had always heard about somebody being so mad they saw black. I saw black. I was like, I don't even remember doing that. But I had a kid that all day long at school was coming up behind me, popping me on the head. And I wasn't even close to this kid. He just picked me out to pick on me. And at the end of the day, we was headed for the buses. And he came up behind me and he walked in his damn hall and he slapped me like that. And I remember like seeing black. I remember like getting so mad. And the next thing I know, I had grabbed him by the arm and just pulled him. I was in my mind was slinging him in front of me to get him out from behind me. And what happened was there was double doors with a steel post in the middle. And I slung him into that and he hit his head right on that post. So I slung him forward and he hit his head. And guess what happened?
He got in trouble.
He didn't do that anymore. He didn't do it anymore, but I felt bad about it. I thought I could have knocked him out or put him in the hospital doing that. And I snapped. You know what? As Christians, we have to be careful about that, don't we? We have to be cautious about somebody picking on you. And it's probably one of the weakest points as Christians is to not want to get back and strike back at somebody. When they push you, and that's the way the little fights start in high school, you know, what are you going to do? Your best bet is to say nothing. And then they'll walk on. They're looking for somebody to respond, aren't they? You know what? The devil will leave you alone if you don't ever respond to his pushing your buttons. He'll move on to somebody weaker. You have to be strong in it. Amen. Lay aside all malice and guile. That's deceit. You know what? Peter says that we're not supposed to be deceiving. Now, how do you deceive people in the church? Well, you act like you're all just like one of them when you're maybe not. Come to church and act like, you know, yeah, I'm just like you guys. I love the Lord. And the rest of the week, all 6.5 days, because probably the half of Sunday you're not walking as a Christian. For 6.5 days, you're just living like the world. You're doing what you want to do in your flesh. And then for half a day on Sunday, you love the Lord. Imagine if I only loved Angie when I was at home and then when I was at work, I talked about her. Or I just didn't even think about her. That's ridiculous, isn't it? It's really sad for Christians to deceive and act like, you know, we're and not even have a spirit of humility where we at least act like, you know what, I'm trying. Right? Hypocrisies. It literally means the act of a stage player. It means being an actor. He said, lay aside hypocrisies. So instead of acting like something that you're not, stop doing that. You can never get your life straightened out if you're acting as a hypocrite. Right? If you're if you have deceit and guile and hypocrisies, you can never get your life straightened. At least if you're trying to be yourself around everybody and quit trying to hide the fact that you're into some sin or that you really aren't walking with God or you really don't love him, then you can get your life straight. This is what in Revelation where he talks about being hot or cold. You either need to be hot or cold. Don't be lukewarm. Don't be just be in the middle of the road and you just, well, I'll be over here with the hot people now. Well, I'm going to be over here with the cold people because that's the, I just like to fit in. I'm just going to, that's what a lot of people have a problem with. If they're not themselves for Christ. They are walking in the flesh, but when they get around people of God, Okay, we'll be around the people of God today. Now we're going to be around it. And that's hypocrisy. One of the funniest things I find in Hollywood is every one of those people are fakes and liars as a job, and yet they stand up and give some political opinion. Have you ever thought about that? Their whole job is to pretend to be something they're not, and then they feel like they have the authority to get out with a microphone and say, I'm backing this political candidate. Oh, well, we just need this. We got to put down these Christians. And they just stand up for such stupidity because the majority of them are liberal. And yet they're fakes and liars. That's their role and their job in life is to be a fake and a liar. You as a Christian don't need to be a fake and a liar, right? You need to make sure that you don't walk in the act of a stage player. And envies is just envy. Why would we envy anything as a Christian? We have it made. We may not have any material things, but we have a mansion in glory. You know, we could live in the most rundown shack on this planet, have ratty clothes, have just basic food to eat, and still be happier than the richest man on this planet. You know why? Because we know what's important. We know what's eternal. This few 60, 70, 80 years living on life, on earth is nothing to be compared to eternity, right? So when we think about this, don't be envying anybody. There's no reason for you to be envying people. Put that aside. Put that off. You have a new mentality, a new spiritual walk with God. When you do that, when you understand that, you can just forget about having all that material stuff and all that money that you thought was so important before you came. Hopefully it'll come back in just a minute. Evil speaking. Backbiting. This has a lot to do with what I said earlier of malice and ill will and trying to injure people. The evil speaking is the things that go on every day on social media when someone says this and someone responds with this and then someone says this. And it's that high school hallway shoving and pushing that goes on. And it's caused by egos of people who want to act like they've got the last word. I'm better than you, or I'm smarter than you, I know more than you. And when I do this, I'm actually telling everybody how stupid I am because I keep responding to that. You know what? If you scroll by and you see something you don't agree with, keep scrolling. You don't have to respond to it. Right? You don't have to respond to that. If you want to put something on your own wall about something, but you don't have to go to somebody else's wall on Facebook or whatever social media you use and say something. Now, some of you are not even on social media. I understand that. I think that's actually a great thing. Defamation, backbiting, evil speaking. Do we talk about people when we really shouldn't? We do, don't we? And we really have to put that aside. So these are the things that Peter says to put aside so that we're not in sin. These are things we learn as Christians that we take off and put aside, just like my old dirty clothes, and take that off. Quit doing that, right? Put aside evil speaking. And in verse 2, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word that you may grow thereby. Now, so many times I have been teaching that you need to go for the meat, right? You need to go for the meat. Make sure you go for the meat of the word. Well, sometimes you need to go back to the milk. Sometimes you need to go back for the milk because he said that you may grow thereby. And it may be that you've not had growth in your life in a while. Maybe you feel like you're a mature Christian, but you kind of stopped growing. Maybe you need a glass of milk. Think about it. I mean, even as adults, you know, we all, as babies, were raised on milk, solid milk, 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 nothing but milk. That's kind of an incredible thing that can be such a wholesome, complete food for a person, right? And I don't like milk because I worked in the dairy after high school and had really nothing but milk to drink in a hot August 1977. I was working there on the dock loading and unloading milk trucks, and there was no water to drink, only old milk. So you can see why I don't like drinking milk. I barely have a little bit on cereal if I ever do that. But some people need a little milk every now and then, don't they? You need some milk. So Peter says, sincerely desire the milk of the word, or desire the sincere milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. So sometimes you need milk, and you need to go back to some basic things in the Bible, don't you? Especially if you find that there's not been growth in a while. Go back to the milk. Amen. Desire, the Greek for that is crave, long for, pursue with love. Crave, long for, pursue with love. The sincere milk, the pure, unmixed truths. And of course, the milk is a metaphor for the simple things in the Word of God. We often refer to the meat of the Word as something that's a little stronger, a little harder to understand, something that really only the mature people can grasp. Now, I'll give you an example. I quoted something from Revelation a few weeks ago, and it stirred up quite a bit of young people in here about, what is this book of Revelation? What is that? Because they've not heard much from it. And Revelation is not something that you need to study as a young Christian, right? If you jump right in and you've just been born again and you jump into Revelation, you go, whoa, what have I gotten myself into? But when you get older and more mature, there are some things in the Bible that you can read, right? It's not for your age, but it will be later. It's not just your age, but your spiritual maturity, correct? So if you get more mature, you will be studying deeper things of God. Right now, I know Granny's got your Bible study for you young people every week, and she goes through some very basic Bible stories, goes through it in depth, and you're learning such good foundational things. But I guarantee you there won't be much from Revelation out there, will there? Is that right, Granny? No Revelation taught out there. There will be some very basic Bible stories. And what's the felt board that you use? Betty Lucas. Luker? Lucan. Betty Lucan. Felt boards. Been around for years, and I still haven't learned about it. The felt board that she teaches the stories with, and you have memorized as well. That's the milk of the word. Amen. So Peter says to desire the sincere milk of the word that you may grow thereby. Verse 3, if so be, you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Now we're kind of shifting gears, and we're going to go 4-8. To whom coming as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious, ye also as lively stones are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Wherefore also it is contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Sion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Unto you therefore which believe, he is precious, but unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed. So Peter goes in immediately to the rock of Christ Jesus, and he talks about this. And so I'm going to talk about it for just a minute, because Jesus, the analogy of Jesus is that he's the chief cornerstone. And he talks about us, a living stone, and that we are living stones. That's kind of an interesting thing. I know that all you kids like to play with Legos. We got a big Lego corner, big pile of Legos, probably a 5-gallon bucket full of Legos back there. We got piles of Legos, and you love building things like that. Those things can be made into anything, but you have to start with something, don't you? You have to start with an idea. You might get a piece, and you might say, I'm going to build this. That kind of looks like the base of an airplane. I need some wings. And you start looking for wings and you start building on that. Well, Jesus was the first and the building stone that everything was built on. Now, the world doesn't like to acknowledge this. They like to disavow Jesus. They like to overlook Jesus. They like to say that he's not important. Some people even say that he didn't even really exist, but there's so much physical proof of that and historical proof that it's impossible to deny that. But even then, they don't like to accept that he is the Son of God and he is the only way to heaven. They don't like to accept that. So when we look at him, he is the chief cornerstone. Now, when he says that, they had a better understanding of building than we do. What do we do today? We want something built, we hire somebody to build it. If we want a house built, we hire somebody to do it, correct? But they built them things themselves. The whole community would get together. And when they started on something, they would have a cornerstone. They would have a place to start. When you have a piece of property that you're going to build on, you have to have a place to start. And you say, I want my house to be right in the center of my property. I want it to start right here, and I want it to go that way. And that's what this was. This was the cornerstone. It was the original stone that was put down, one that laid out. And this stone had to have square sides, right? It had to be flat here, and it had to be flat here, and it had to be 90 degrees apart. And if it wasn't, then the whole thing was off. And so when that stone was put down, that was a place, a standard that was put. Do you know that even time, our calendars are divided by Jesus? AD, BC, have you ever heard those years? That time, even for the world, is set up by Jesus. There were years, if we're looking back in history, the BC years before Christ and the AD years and the year of our Lord, Anno Domini is what it means, and the year of our Lord. People stop saying that. They like to try to overlook that, but that's what the years are. The year 2023 that we're in, that's because it's 2023 after Jesus. Did you know that? So Jesus was a standard in history. The standards that he have, and he is the standard for coming to God. Amen. Now he gives some passages here. And he says that he is a living stone and that we are also living stones. Let's look in Romans 12:1. Romans 12:1. That's a cuckoo. All right, Romans 12:1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. So Paul says that we present our bodies as a living sacrifice. When you lay yourself down as a building block, that's a sacrifice, isn't it? Amen? Amen. When you have pieces back there, the Lego that you build with, when you have building blocks that you build with, that is a sacrifice. So how do we sacrifice as Christians? Well, you're sacrificing today, aren't you? Because you're here. Everybody in here is sacrificing. Everybody that's listening on the internet is sacrificing. You're sacrificing time. You're sacrificing of yourself, right? It's a sacrifice for a Christian to walk, to read, to study, to pray, to witness. Everything that we do like that is a sacrifice. Now, we often think of sacrifices as something, well, I guess I better give some money because that's my sacrifice. That's great if you've got money to give. Not everybody has money to give. We need to make sure that we are sacrificing and being those living stones, amen? If the stone that Jesus is and is laid there is just by itself, it is nothing, is it? It's nothing. But because we are the living stones, that are put on top of that, the house of God is built. Right? The house of God is built because we are laid there with the living stone. Now, we have all the apostles and the saints and the martyrs in the that we know about, and there's so many we don't know about. There's so many names that we'll never know about till we get to heaven. You know people that are living during your lifetime, and you know a little bit of church history, and we can go through the martyr's mirror, and we can see those people. And they're all stones in the body of Christ, stones in that church. But you are a stone too, right? You're a stone too. And he talked about the stone that the builders rejected. And let's look in 1 Corinthians 1:23. But we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. So he talks about a stumbling block. And isn't it true, though, that Jesus is a stumbling block to those who don't use him to build on? I get this mental image in my head. I've had this for years of having this big building area, and there's a big block there. And it's kind of unusual. There's not another one like it. Maybe you've got a lot of concrete blocks that are all the same, and then you've got this one big rock. And that rock looks different than anything else. It's bigger than anything else. It's heavy. It's laid down somewhere, and you're not going to be able to move it. And you just keep feeling like that thing is just in the way, right? That big block is just in the way. What are we going to do about it? We can't dynamite that thing. We can't get equipment in here to move it. That thing's in the way. And then the reality, that thing is what we're supposed to start with. In reality, that is the cornerstone. In reality, that's where you're supposed to start. And we overlook it so many times when we overlook Jesus being where he is. We don't like him being where he is sometimes. I didn't know I was going to have to do that. I didn't know this Christian walk was going to be so hard. I didn't know I was going to have to give up this for my flesh. I didn't know that this part of fun in my life wasn't going to be allowed. I didn't know. And all the stuff that you go through of after being born again, and you say, I didn't know that. Jesus is the cornerstone, and we're supposed to be building on that. And have we skipped that in our life? Think about it. Have you skipped building on Jesus? Maybe you built a few things and then you started building somewhere else. Then you're missing out. You're missing out on what God has for your life. You're missing out on building on the cornerstone of Christ Jesus. Amen. Matthew 21:42. Jesus saith unto them, did you never read the scriptures? The stone which the builders rejected, the same has become the head of the corner. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore say I unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you and given to a nation, bringing forth the fruits thereof. And whosoever shall fall on this stone shall be broken, but on whomsoever it shall fall, it will grind him to powder. Jesus was indicating that the Jews would reject him, and they did. And he was indicating that this kingdom shall be given, taken from you, the Jews, and given to a nation, bringing forth the fruits thereof, the Gentiles, the church, the body of Christ that we know today. Now, there are some Jewish people that are born again, but he was trying to help them realize and look back on this to say, you rejected me, but you're going to come back later, right? The stone that the builders rejected, the one they stumbled over. There's so many people that stumble over things But in reality, they need to take a step up and use it to reach God. It's a stepping stone, isn't it? Amen. This analogy of the chief cornerstone, and I'm giving you these very quickly. This is also in Mark 12:10, Ephesians 2:20, Psalms 118:22, 1 Corinthians 3:11, Isaiah 8:14, Acts 4:11, and Romans 9:33. All of those talk about the cornerstone, which is Christ Jesus. All of that scripture. That is pretty prominent, isn't it? That he is the cornerstone. Now, how important is this cornerstone? Well, I built several things in my life, and I always have to start with a corner. I have to start with something. I have to start with a stake driven in the ground and strings and batter boards. I have to start with something to lay that out. Now, I get everything square off of that one corner. You know, even property, when it's surveyed, has something, a starting point, doesn't it? Ours is right down here. There's an axle driven in the ground. And some of you kids down there someday, I'll show it to you. There's something driven in the ground down there that my property starts with. And the surveyors take that starting point and they go to each corner and they come back. And when they come back to it, it has to come out exactly to that, or they're off somewhere. That's the starting point and the ending point. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Amen? And he is the corner. In 1 Peter 2:8, a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed. There are a lot of people that reject Christ. They think, if I just ignore him, he'll go away. They think, if I just won't have, I don't have anything to do with him. Doesn't affect me. It will affect you. Amen? It will affect you. One day when you stand before God, he will say, what did you do with Jesus? He will say, what did you do with my son that I sent to die for you? And say, well, I left him alone. I didn't speak bad about his name. No, you just ignored him. You just did nothing with him. We have to make sure that we start with Jesus. When he gave the parable of the man that built his house on the solid rock, he is the solid rock. Amen? And remember, the other man built his house on sand. Correct? So the person that's built their life on Jesus will succeed when the storm comes. Some people have not built their life on Jesus. The storm hasn't come yet. The storm hasn't come yet. A lot of people are walking their own way, doing their own thing. When the storm comes, they will fall. They can act like they won't, but the storm will come and they will crash to the earth. They will fall. And hopefully during that time, they'll see the error of their ways and they will see that they should have built on Jesus and they will have a chance to repent. That's my prayer for them. But if you built your life on Jesus, you can be sure that when the storm comes, you will be solid. You will be secure. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this word. I thank you that Jesus is the cornerstone in our lives, that he is the solid foundation that we built on. Lord, I pray for those that have not built on Jesus, that they would tear down what they have built so far because it is not built on you. And that they would build up again, even if it means taking back sections of their life and starting again. Lord, it's always better to start again at the bottom of the hill than to end up at the top of the wrong mountain. And I just pray that you would, Lord, just give us wisdom as we look at this scripture and help us all to discern it in our lives. And I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.